Special Shakespearean edition of QI dedicated to and entitled The Immortal Bard. Strutting and fretting their hour upon the stage tonight are the two gentlemen of Verona, David Mitchell, Bill Bailey. The Merry Wife of Windsor, Sue Perkins. And Much Ado About Nothing, Alan Davies. So, let the trumpet sound, David goes. Nice. Sue goes. Bill goes. And Alan goes. So, let's take to the stage, good gentles all. When David Tennant played Hamlet at the RSC, what did Tchaikovsky play?
What?
Tchaikovsky.
Tchaikovsky being the composer, Tchaikovsky.
Was he in the cast, Tchaikovsky?
He was
Peter Ilyich.
Not no. Peter Ilyich Tchaikovsky, the Russian composer. Mm. Oh. Another musician called Tchaikovsky. He was also a pianist, a rather startling and amazing pianist, actually. Most eccentric pianist.
Richard Stilgo.
No, I've already told you his name. It was Tchaikovsky.
Tchaikovsky.
Are you saying he played Richard Stilgo?
Yes.
He blew into Richard Stilgo and a noise came out the other end.
You're putting him in the past tense, so I am assuming he may have shuffled off his mortal coil.
To quote Hamlet.
To quote.
Indeed.
And that will be the only quote. That's it now. I've blown all my quotes.
But you've done damn well. It's a good start. Yes.
So if he's dead... So
he was dead.
He was dead. So he's not alive.
Skull. So he's a skull.
Yes, he played the skull. Here we don't have the real skull there. That's what a skull looks like. He was a very passionate Shakespearean. That is the real thing there, was Tchaikovsky, and he bequeathed it to the Royal Shakespeare Company, asking that it be used in productions of Hamlet for the part of... Do you remember the character? Whose skull it is that Hamlet...
Is it Yorick?
Yorick.
Yes. Yorick, yes.
Poor Yorick.
Alas, poor Yorick. I knew him, Horatio. Fellow of infinite jest.
Yes, well, they went, alas, poor... Wait a minute, this is Tchaikovsky, isn't it?
<not Yorick. laughs>
He can play a tune on his teeth.
there was quite a bit of trouble. There were health and safety issues. There had to be a human tissue licence had to be ordered in order for him to appear on stage.
Did they cut his head off? I mean, presuming so he's gone, when I die, I'd like my skull to be used by the RSC. But someone's got to saw it off and then rot it down a bit.
The funeral director was rather loath to do this. They thought it might be illegal, but they had to get clearance. And David Tennant every day held it in his hand. Tchaikovsky would have been very pleased. That's what he wanted, after all.
Yeah.
There he is looking at
Look
it.
At that.
Yeah.
A tramp yesterday.
You hope they've had to dirty it up again.
Oh, they very much, yes.
So that's not just a bit of the guy that's still clean.
There's a little face still on there he's got to wash off.
It's a long time since I've seen Hamlet, but because it's such a well-known bit, you don't really question what happens in it. And it's an odd thing to do, to pick up a bloke's skull from a graveyard.
But somebody knew.
And then to sort of go, alas, you know, I knew him well. You, rather than going, I feel a bit weird having picked up his skull.
That's sort of what he's saying. He's saying, you know, it's ridiculous. I knew this man. I would sit on his lap when I was a boy. And he's just, we're wont to set the table on a roar. And he looks at him and says, so where are your jokes now?
Yeah. You know, not so funny now.
It is one of the great contemplations of death and mortality. And it must be even weirder when you're doing it to a real... person like that. David Tennant presumably knew the story that he was doing it to this chap who wanted it to be a symbol of death.
It's going to be like I'm a Celebrity, isn't it? Agents are going to get put their acts down to have their skulls put use in there. Yeah, oh yeah, no, I'll get you your skull. You'll be in Shakespeare one day.
It'd be awful, wouldn't it, though, if for your whole life you'd wanted to be an actor and it hadn't really worked out, and so you bequeathed your skull and it was used in a major production of Hamlet, and then all the reviewers said, I don't know, Yorick felt a bit stilted.
Totally
ruined that scene.
Now, name the Scottish play that Shakespeare wrote.
Ah, Taggart.
Taggart!
It's not... Yeah, you see, you're trying to trick us, aren't you? You tricksy little QI. Yeah. Two Gentlemen of Kilmarnock or something, isn't it? The Teeman of Strathclyde. Old Gowan Macbeth!
Yes.
Is it?
Yes. No, we thought that as actors you might say never, never, I never say it. Then it would have got the forfeit.
Ah,
you said never.
I can do the forfeit.
Because, of course, as you know, there is a tradition, is there not? The very saying of the name Macbeth in a theatre is bad luck.
You have to sleep with all your co-stars immediately.
Is that what you were told?
Yes.
Why? Interesting.
What?
Do you know how this came about, this reputation of Macbeth for being an unlucky play?
Well, is it
play?
Because the Macbeth was the sort of the play in a company's repertoire that they'd bring out when something closed suddenly? Because it was sort of short and usually went down quite well. And so mention of Macbeth would imply that the current production was soon to close.
It's certainly true. It's the shortest of the tragedies, and it's a banker. People always go and see Macbeth. It's a popular play.
Yes.
Now, there is actually a really specific reason. It was a hoax. A late 19th century wit who was writing a review of Macbeth just made up this story that this play's cursed, you know. It was Max Beerbohm who had made this story up entirely. Although then, not many years later, in the 1942 production of Dear Johnny Gielgud...
Dear, dear Johnny.
Yes. Four people died in that production.
What?
Yes.
Is that the one where they used machine guns to bring Burnham Wood to Dunsinane?
They certainly used searing makeup, didn't they?
Oh, that's fantastic.
It's always good to go with an inflatable crown.
Yeah.
Yes, the two witches died, the Duncan died, and the scene designer. The set was then redesigned for a comedy, and the principal in that died. The radiant Diana Wynyard, 30s and 40s actress, you may remember, there she is. Yeah. She played Lady Macbeth and thought it would be more convincing in the sleepwalking scene to have her eyes closed, and she walked off the stage into the orchestra pit. Certainly. Not, I don't know whether that's Macbeth's curse or being a stupid actress.
They were all... They're all watching her go and just let her go.
Yeah. This is the only way she'll live.
Yes.
Did she carry on going from the bowels?
She brained her out, damn sport! And she climbed out again, apparently.
Doing it all through rehearsals. I'm going to carry on.
There's a few things that were actually not... that weren't, you know, hoaxes, were real, had some practical applications, like whistling. That was always sort of imbued into me every time when I did a play. It was like, don't whistle.
Yes, no.
Backstage.
You are a terrible whistler.
Maybe it was that. Maybe it was.
Yeah.
No, it's because that's how they used to cue the scenery coming
that's
down.
That's right, they used whistles for cues.
And
boof. So you could have a nasty accident.
You could, yeah, exactly.
Isn't it ridiculous, though, that the way they got people to stop whistling is by saying, oh, it's a superstition, it's bad luck, and then people, oh, right, I won't then. People should adopt that with mobile phones. You tell people, oh, you're in the audience of a theatre, and maybe you want to turn your phone off so that, you know, if somebody rings you, it doesn't spoil it for everyone else. People sort of go, well, I hear that, but also I'm going to leave my phone on. If you tell them it's bad luck, they'll presumably all turn it off.
Yeah.
Yes. Like a curse. Like an ancient curse.
Yeah.
Tutankhamun said before he died, couldn't abide the sound of a Nokia ringtone. Cursed it.
I suppose you are.
I can't say it of you.
Or if you put there was an article in, I don't know, say the Daily Mail, suggesting that other people's disapproval was carcinogenic.
Well, yes. Brilliant. Or your house price might go down slightly.
A tidal wave of immigrants would suddenly invade the country, says Melanie Phillips. Should you turn your mobile
phone off? Turn your mobile phone off, or Kosovan squirrels will steal your thimbles.
Your nuts.
I was in a theatre not long ago when a phone went off and the actor just said, "Oh, for fuck's sake!"
Turned to you in the audience.
Not to
not
me.
To you.
I'm glad to say it. On this occasion, I was in a... There was a time when sometimes doctors are needed on stage. When Ralph Richardson suddenly went up and said, "Excuse me, is there a doctor in the house?" And the man put his hand up and said, "Yes, I'm a doctor." He said, "Oh, doctor, isn't this an awful place?"
The best one is the Piers Adora. That's my
all-time favourite. Do tell
the Piers Adora when there was a production of The Diary of Anne Frank and Piers Adora was in it. She was so bad that when the Nazis came downstairs, somebody shouted out, "She's in the attic!" Come on, son. In the attic! Get it over with.
What about Richard Harris coming on drunk? And someone in the audience said, "Harris is drunk!" And he stood up, because he'd fallen down, he stood up and said, "If you think I'm drunk, wait till you see O'Toole."
The most famous was Peter O'Toole was in the Coach and Horses in Soho one lunchtime having a drink, and he made best friends with the drinker he was standing next to, and they were getting absolutely pissed. And they said, and O'Toole said, "What should we do? Well, let's go and catch a matinee of something." So they wandered down Shaftesbury Avenue, and they said, "Well, let's go in there, see if it's any good." They sat down, both very drunk, and about 10 minutes in, Peter O'Toole nudged his friend and said, "Oh, you like this? This is where I come on." "Oh, fuck!"
I love that. But he knew he had to be somewhere.
Yeah.
His subconscious took him there somehow.
We're in Edinburgh. We did this production of 12 Angry Men, and one of the jurors fainted on stage, and his eyes rolled back, and he's anywhere. And his head hit the table, bang, like that. So all of us picked him up bodily and carried him off the stage. And you see the audience going, "I don't remember a bit where one of the jurors dies." It was terribly. It was very hot that year. And I remember somebody fainted in the audience as well, and she cartwheeled down through the stairs like this. And she went ragdolled all the way down to the front of the stage. Whoa. And people were going like that. And she knocked over someone in a wheelchair, right? And he fell out of his chair like that. Then the boyfriend got up, came down, saw his girlfriend unconscious, and he fainted. Right. So there was a pile of bodies at the front.
How bizarre.
It's a very odd thing to faint at the sight of unconsciousness. Not at the sight of blood.
Yeah. I can't bear sleeping people. Yeah. I have to do something.
Oh my gosh, he's.
One would trigger another and then another and then another, and then the whole world would, if most people had it.
Be a very low key version of a zombie movie.
Well, yes, Max Beerbohm it was who invented the curse of Macbeth in 1898. Leonard Bernstein wrote a musical based on Romeo and Juliet and set it in New York. What was it originally called?
Is it Greek?
Was it West Side Story?
It became West Side Story, but it was originally called...
East Side Story.
Yes! Originally, when they were working on it, in the late 40s, it was gangs of Catholics versus gangs of Jews down in the Lower East Side. And then 5 years later, as they were working on it, they decided they wanted Puerto Ricans against white gangs, and that was the
Catholics would be
west
awful.
Side.
I mean, they just have to tap someone and they just go, "I wish I hadn't done that. I feel awful now." And there's just 10 years of terrible guilt. Puerto Ricans a bit more feisty.
I think they are.
Yeah.
They are. Let's certainly admit that it worked.
Gay and feisty by the look of them.
It's the world of the musical, isn't it? It is. Showgirls all.
All the pipes have been airbrushed out of this photograph.
Oh, heavens above. Now, of course, West Side Story may be the best and certainly probably the best known musical based on a Shakespearean fable, but do you know of any others? Points going.
Kiss Me, Kate.
Kiss Me, Kate, yes, by Cole Porter, was based on
The Taming of the Shrew.
The Taming of the Shrew, yeah. Exactly.
Is Cats based on Hamlet?
No. But, odd as that sounds, there is a stage musical playing in London at the moment that is based on Hamlet.
Is it Hamlet! Exclamation mark.
No. There is Hamlet the musical, but this is a big West End musical based on a big movie that is actually is the story of Hamlet.
Oh, not Spamalot.
Not Spamalot. A young prince.
Oh.
Born.
Yes.
And he's not a human.
Oh.
What? He's not a human. It's E.T.
Thank you, audience. The Lion King is based on Hamlet. Did you not know?
At what point does Hamlet say Hakuna Matata?
What about the Tempest? What were they made of?
Wicked.
The Perfect Storm.
Speed 2.
Harold and Kumar get the munchies.
Well, no, there's Prospero's Books.
Oh, yes.
Is one, but there's another 50s rather classic sci-fi movie.
Oh.
The audience are really joining
Rip
in now. Forbidden
Planet.
Working
title, Rip One Out.
Yeah. And there was one based on the Comedy of Errors musical.
What happens in the Comedy of Errors? Yeah,
there are two sets of identical twins.
Oh, God. One of them's shipwrecked. Who's a girl? Who's a boy? I'm married.
Twins.
Everyone's dead.
The Boys from Syracuse is the name of the musical.
Oh, okay.
Terminator 2.
No.
Shylock is sent back from the future.
Oh, I've got my chain stuck in my ruff. Whoa. That was embarrassing. Yeah.
So it sounded like that it should sound rude.
And yeah,
you think about it. Not really.
So, there we are. Now, what does Sigmund Freud, Mark Twain, Henry James, a loony from Newcastle, and the Holy Ghost have in common?
Well, so, Mark Twain, I know, had a link, but I don't know about the others. And he's sceptical about Shakespeare because he thought that a toff wrote it. He didn't believe that a normal boy from Stratford could write.
Right.
Could write
he
properly.
Was what you might call exactly a Shakespearean sceptic, as were the others. That's to say, Sigmund Freud also believed that, and Henry James, and the Professor Looney, that was unfortunately his name, though I believe it was pronounced Looney from Newcastle, who wrote a book in 1920 called Shakespeare Identified. There was this whole movement, starting in the 19th century, really, with the idea that it might have been Francis Bacon who wrote the works of Shakespeare. Mm. There was particularly a woman called Delia Bacon, who was an American and was completely insane, really. She came over to England and wrote a 625-page book.
God.
In which she didn't even mention the name Bacon. And then when she died, she claimed she was the Holy Spirit.
She claimed she was the Holy Spirit?
Yes. So the Holy Spirit, if she was right, also doesn't believe Shakespeare wrote Shakespeare. So if Bacon was one candidate, there are two other main candidates.
Hang on. No, what was it?
Marlowe.
Christopher Marlowe.
Christopher Marlowe is one candidate. But the most popular
Earl
one...
Earl of Oxford?
The Earl of Oxford is, yes, indeed. Edward de Vere.
Is that Edward de Vere?
That's Edward de Vere.
Wow. There's a lot
that.
Going on there, isn't
there? There is, isn't there?
How does he keep that hat on?
It's sort of Cate Blanchett with a moustache. It's intense.
But, no, there are serious people. I mean, Freud liked the fact that he lost his father early on, like Hamlet. Because, of course, he had an Oedipus complex theory about Hamlet, Freud, so he liked that idea. Who else? Looney invented a rather fanciful scenario because the Earl of Oxford died in 1604 and Shakespeare carried on writing plays many years after that. So
that might almost be the point at which to abandon the theory.
Yeah, you'd think. Instead of which, he claimed that before dying, he'd left a whole sheaf of plays and that his servant, Shakespeare, then just produced them one after the other.
Isn't the Tempest written sort of 4 or 5 years after he died, 6 years maybe even after he died, referencing sort of stuff of the time. So after De Vere's dead.
Yes, quite.
He probably just left insert topical gag here.
Yeah, that's right. But there are Mark Rylance and Derek Jacobi, both supreme actors, and they both believe that it was the Earl of Oxford. There isn't a shred of evidence, as far as I can see.
It sort of doesn't matter. On the basis that what Shakespeare means to people is the guy that wrote those plays. And so if the guy that wrote those plays is a different guy that wrote those plays, that's still what a great guy.
Yes.
It's not an earth-shattering conspiracy, really, is it? That it isn't him
Omen of 5,000 books on the subject, incredibly.
Yeah, I know, it's extraordinary. Oh,
yeah, no scrap of evidence. Speaking.
Not
yeah.
real evidence, to be honest. No, it's just speculation. And the odd thing is, they often say, well, we know so little about Shakespeare. There are very, very few people of the Elizabethan era about whom we know more. I mean, Ben Jonson, for example, who was a very famous playwright, we don't even know where Ben Jonson was born or how many children he had.
If other people were writing the plays, why didn't they say so at the time?
Well, quite. I mean, it's...
That's the bit I don't understand. It always seems like he didn't write all that. Wouldn't it have come out if other people had written?
Yeah, but if it was Ben Jonson or yeah. any of those others... Yeah. Jolly good luck to them, I say.
Was it just because he wasn't posh? Was that? Is it just come? Does it
that
come
is
out basic
kind of snobbery? They think, well, yeah. he was just this kid from Warwickshire, and he was a woodlander, and you know. But in fact, his father was a glover, which is a perfectly decent trade, as you say, and he went to the grammar school there, almost certainly. And
he's sort of, you'd think, exactly as far up the society as you'd expect a major writer to be.
Yes.
Not, you know, it's not like now the best novels are written by the Duke of Westminster.
No. Quite. You know. Very good point. Those people, anyway, claimed that he didn't write his plays, all those ones we saw. But how many words did Shakespeare write?
Oh, that'd be quite a lot. Oh,
how many different words?
Yeah, yes. Yes, well, there are a number of things here. One is simply, how many pieces of his handwriting do we have?
We've got his... There's his signature.
There is his signature a few times, isn't there?
He never spelt his name the same twice.
No, and it's pretty wonky writing, it's got to be said.
Shakespeare.
It's what?
He's probably more used to, you know, typing.
That one says...
He was on the sauce on the top.
He was on something.
Right,
yeah. That one looks as it says Gallipot. William. The William's quite good on one of them. Anyway, this reinforces some people's arguments. You say he got a clerk to write his name. He couldn't even write his own name, they say.
Could he have theoretically dictated these plays then to someone else?
Oh, I suppose it's possible. Barbara Cartland used to lie on a sofa and dictate her marvellous novels. I think A.A. Gill, the journalist, dictates, doesn't he? Because he has very severe dyslexia, so I think he does. Right. So there are people who do.
So he's got bad handwriting and that means he didn't write any plays?
No, it doesn't necessarily mean that, but it is surprising that we don't have many examples of his handwriting because the plays were presumably written out by other people. Now, his vocabulary. How many words do you think he used? I'm not counting repeats. The, he used a lot, obviously.
Yeah. Dagger, murder.
This could take us a long time, yes.
Well, we've got to start somewhere.
You've got to start somewhere, you're
start
right.
Somewhere.
Yeah.
5,000, yeah.
That's 20,000 words.
20,000
words. And how does that compare to the average vocabulary of a Briton, would we say, roughly? That we
Four
know?
Times as much.
No, half as much. Half as much.
Less.
Surprisingly, yes. I mean, we're not saying that Shakespeare used every word he knew in his books. I'm sure he left lots out. I don't remember the word clitoris.
He didn't use hard drive.
I think it's in the second folio.
Oh, it might be. You know. So it's about half that of the average modern English person's vocabulary, because obviously he didn't have certain words to call on, like, you know, texting or vajazzle or whatever. But on the other hand, he did have, you know, girdon and bodkin and fardel. Which we don't use so much.
Yogurt.
I don't suppose Shakespeare knew what yogurt was.
Broadband.
Exactly. Activia pouring yogurt was a phrase you never heard him say. I can't get my
head.
I
don't use that string. If it
never
had it. Yeah.
If I were to say I couldn't get my head round Activia pouring yogurt, it would sound peculiar. But why would we want to pour a yogurt?
What you want is pouring furniture. Because it's quite difficult getting furniture. If you could pour the furniture where you wanted it and to the extent you wanted it.
And it sets.
And that, exactly. Yeah. Then
it could
be
made out
handy.
Of that thing like Terminator 2 is made out of.
Yeah. No,
yeah,
they've got,
yes, exactly.
They've got
yes.
that already. There's concrete.
Oh, yeah. You try
and make a piano out of concrete.
I will. I'll give it a bloody good go.
Essentially, you want spray on wood. Don't you? I'm not talking about Viagra.
Hey.
But, you know, where you could sort of go, you could go.
Well, I think the future is 3D printing, is it not? Have you not seen some examples of that?
Oh, that's amazing.
It is extraordinary, isn't it?
I've seen that. That's some kind of voodoo.
It really is phenomenal. Phenomenal.
Is that just model, so it can create a 3D object?
Yeah. Yes.
You put an object into a case like that.
Like a vole, so
like
a vole.
Say a vole. Well, not maybe not. A vole, yeah. But, you'd have to have it sedated in some way. You wouldn't want it moving around.
It's been very humanely treated. It's sleeping.
It's sleeping and probably laminated. And, and then you press a button and then you leave it for a few hours and you come back and there's another vole.
Yeah. That's cloning. How come that's not... That's...
Lasers make calibrations of exact every single detail of it. I mean, really, really complex things.
It can be printed. Off,
well, it can be made of different things, different plastics and resins and so on. But, I've seen some really complex things.
You can make a marzipan valve. Yes. Oh, wonders of technology.
Oh, thank God.
all those years
of postgraduate research.
Hallelujah.
And we have a marzipan.
Yeah. Wheel, steam engine, microchip, marzipan.
It's the decline of human civilization.
Yeah, that's when we knew it had all gone wrong with the Battenberg rodent. Oh, well. Still, there are a lot of words. In The Sun, David Crystal, who's a well-known linguistic fellow, and he estimated there would be about 6,000 words in any complete issue of The Sun, whereas the King James Bible has just 8,000. So this idea that we're all dumbed down to a lower vocabulary is not necessarily true. Anyway, moving on. Shakespeare coined over 1,000 new words, but not all of them caught on. Here are some of the ones that didn't. See if you can put them into a sentence for me. Sweltery, quatch.
Watch. I've got a sweltery quatch at the moment.
Already we're there, aren't we?
It happened when I put my kicky wickies on. The cock will be fox-shipped. Yeah. I've always been near-legged.
You're a boggler in those times.
A boggle be Carlot.
You're fox-shipped. What happened to cockled boggler?
Carlot, that's a thing. That's where people sell
second-hand
cars.
That's a sexy
garage.
Well, that's true, actually.
Well, it has ahead taken of its time.
Way ahead of its time. Yeah.
A boggler is a very clumsy burglar.
Or it's a burglar that can't believe the stuff he's getting his hands on. Look at this DVD player.
Well, he used it to mean a hesitator, one who boggles. Like I think that was in boggling the mind.
What is a kicky wicky? Is that like a Russell Brand's version of a football or something?
It's an affectionate term for a wife. Oh, my dear Kiki Wiki.
A Kiki Wiki is not an affectionate term.
Domestic violence is a lot more acceptable.
Oh, the old smashy washy. The old battery washery. Punchy wunchy.
And a quatch. Or quatch. Is it a quatch? It's actually an adjective.
A fetch.
Quatch. Quatch means a bit podgy, a bit quatch.
What? Oh, you're a bit quatchy.
Yeah.
Luckily, I'm wearing a surgical truss.
Clumpsh of me. Whoppened, or wappened, is corrupt. That's never really caught on, has it? But look at the ones that did catch on. Here's just a small example of words that are first used in Shakespeare. Accessible, acutely assembled, barefaced, beguiling critic, even-handed, eyeball, Frenchwoman, eyeball. Hunchbacked, neglected, overpower, promising, radiance, revealing, rose-cheeked. School day synonyms, three-legged.
Well, French woman, it's a bit of a stretch. French woman. Invented it.
He invented taking the space out.
Yes, he may have done. Even-handed, bewitchment.
This is my wife, she is a loser. A thingamajig, I don't know. What can I call her? Oh, French woman.
I think you're called.
She's
French woman. French woman?
Of course, you can't be absolutely certain he invented all these because they may have been in use before, but he is often the first printed source we have for them.
He presumably had to have a pretty good idea that people would understand what he was going on about.
Yes, exactly. Also, there are phrases he came up with, of course, and those probably now have come into the realm of cliché, so much so that we can't even imagine that they didn't exist in the English language. There are very many. We've got a list here.
Neither a
boy. Be all and end all. Laid on with a trowel, laughing stock, more in sorrow than in anger, once more into the breach. One fell swoop, play fast and loose. There's the rub, thereby hangs a tail.
How do you say what the Dickens? Dickens didn't come along for another 2 months.
Exactly. A wild goose chase, that's one of his. A heart of gold, high time. The devil is due, the game's up, forever in the day. Dead as a doornail, that's one of his. Ah. Foregone conclusion. And of course, many more that aren't there. To the manor born. It is cruel to be kind.
Basically, the title of every programme will ever be.
Yes, you did give a lot of titles.
Yeah.
If you're having trouble making up a programme title, open your Shakespeare.
Yes, go to the Shakespeare randomiser.
That's what they did. Yeah. Oh, I've done it again.
Oh, no.
This bit of rough is not behaving. I've said that before. Oh, dear. So there we are. Call me our Sweltery Boggler if you like, but answer me this. How did Dangerous Dan Tucker clean up Shakespeare?
Oh, mm-hmm. I sense I'm falling to a pit, but I shall do it anyway. Mm-hmm. Don't know why I'm speaking like that. That's the hat. did he do an abridged version, take out the mucky bits, like the boggling in the...
No, he didn't, I'm afraid. He didn't figure out all the bits. People did, as we know, but just to think of his name, Dangerous Dan, what does that make you think of?
It makes me think of the Wild West.
Yes, stay in the Wild West, then. And what did people, like names like... Dangerous Dan, when they cleaned something up, it was unlikely to be a broom cupboard or some spare bedroom. It would be a whole...
Outlaws.
It would be a town. They'd clean
town.
Up.
Yeah.
And cleaned up the town of Shakespeare.
Clean up this town.
Oh.
There was a town called Shakespeare. There it is. It's now a ghost town.
Wow. That looks like a fun way to spend a weekend.
And it's in New Mexico. And it was lawless back in the day. So they sent for Dangerous Dan, who was a pretty violent sheriff.
Hence the dangerous
bit. Yeah, well, quite. He really was dangerous, too. He'd already been a city marshal in Silver City, where he was a deputy sheriff. He killed a drunken man who was standing on the street throwing rocks at people. Just went up and shot him. So he didn't put up with bad behaviour. He was a zero-tolerance sheriff. Yeah. So within the space of a few months in Shakespeare, he shot dead a cattle rustler. He killed a man who rode into a hotel riding a horse. Arrested and hanged the outlaw Russian Bill Tattenbaum for stealing a horse, and he hanged Sandy King for being a damned nuisance.
Thank God they can't do that anymore.
Well, really, quite. He's being a damned nuisance.
About 17 people who live in those houses.
Yeah, he wiped out the entire population.
No more trouble here?
Yeah.
Of course, the little trap you fell into, the rewriting of Shakespeare, was primarily the work of a famous couple whose name was...
Richard and Judy.
The Bowdlers, indeed, absolutely, the Bowdlers.
Thomas
and Harriet Bowdler. Let's not forget Harriet.
Harriet.
He was particularly strong with her blue pencil. She saw a word like swoggle or something. So they brought out children's editions of Shakespeare, which all the bloody nasty bits were cut out.
They give the tragedies happy ending.
Naam Tate certainly wrote a version of King Lear with a happy ending, and that was very popular for over 100 years.
People like happy endings.
They do, don't they?
I'd say, give them what they want, big song at the end.
Well, actually, funnily enough, you know, they did give them what they want, a big song at the end. Even after a tragedy, on would come a comic and do a jig and make a lot of jokes about the tragedy. That's the way
it's a blow wind, crack your cheeks. My mother-in-law!
Exactly.
Don't worry, it was all pretend.
Now, how did Shakespeare's bottom get to Norwich?
Well, are there relics, bits of him?
Well, he had a famous comedian who played Bottom and Falstaff.
Who did?
Shakespeare. Oh. And he created them for him. He was well known. He was considered the funniest man in England. And his name is sometimes put, it says Kemp instead of Bottom on the original play script, because it was so obviously Kemp who was going to play him. Will Kemp, his name was. But he had a dreadful falling out with Shakespeare or with whoever was running the company, well, with Burbage or somebody. And he went off in the right half. But he decided, as a publicity stunt, he would Morris dance all the way to Norwich from London.
Oh. That's unnecessary.
He did it. It took him about 3 weeks, but he did it over the course of 9 days. And there's a famous phrase that comes from this thing that he did.
And cocking about?
No.
He wrote a book. Tit of yourself.
Kemp's 9 Days Wonder. It was a 9 Days Wonder. That's where the phrase "a 9 Days Wonder" comes from. And he just did it to draw publicity to himself. He said, I may have left Shakespeare Company, but I'm the man, and they're going to go down now. And unfortunately, quite the reverse happened. He went off to Italy and died in penury. His gravestone just says, Kemp, a man. And after he left, the first play Shakespeare wrote was Henry V, in which Falstaff dies off stage. So Kemp was kind of got rid of that way. And a new man called Armin came in and played the comedians. But while we're on the subject of Will Kemp there and his Morris dancing, let me ask this. What do you call a group of Morris dancers?
An arse.
Swarm.
Swarm.
An embarrassment.
Oh.
Plague.
A bell end. With a bell end. Honestly, poor old Britain, we've got one folk tradition in England, and all we do is laugh at it.
But it's absolutely true. People, it really generates hostility,
people get,
dancing.
And people get so mean about it.
I think we think they're up to something.
It's charming.
a perv of Morris dancing.
I think it's very valuable that we can point to that and say, see, it's a free country.
We're not doing that in Afghanistan.
Really, yeah, really, if we were going to ban anything,
it would
we'd
be
ban that.
You know what's going to happen? You see, if this scene now of all us dressed like this and this photograph yeah, here yeah, behind us like that, is we're going to end up as like an "and finally" section on foreign news programmes. <Yeah. laughs> If you know more, Les Anglais.
It's known as a side, anyway.
A side.
A side group of Morris men. I mean, no one quite knows where Morris dancing comes from. We think it's from Morisco, as in Moorish, maybe, where to celebrate the expulsion of the Moors from Spain, various dances, and it's spread into England that way. But certainly not pagan and mystical and anything like that. It's pretty recent. 14th century is the earliest you can go back to it. There are 150 sides now registered in the USA. So American Morris dancing is taking off in a big way.
They'll
That's
be on,
three per state on average.
I've joined a bell end.
This is what they do in old England. Merry England.
There's an Arctic Morris group based in Helsinki. But now, time to visit that undiscovered country from whose bourne no idiot returns as we ring down the curtain on general ignorance. Sound drums and trumpets, farewell, sour annoy, for here, I hope, begins our lasting joy. Fingers on buzzers, in other words. What best describes, in one word, Richard III's appearance?
Hunchback!
There's no evidence at all that Richard III had a hunched back. Just the black propaganda of the Tudors who succeeded him.
But the character in the play does.
The character in the play does, yeah, certainly.
And a limp, a sort of arm, twisted arm, isn't he?
A bottled spider, one of the things he's called. What a hideous name, isn't it? But no, it seems he was a rather decent fellow, in many respects. Intelligent, kind. There was a man called Polydor Virgil, who was a historian who was determined to paint Richard III as black as possible, and so described him as ugly, because in those days they associated ugliness and so on with much as we do today, with wickedness. So, while on that sort of thing, how beautiful was Cleopatra?
She was minging.
Well, I think sort of a bit weird-looking, but sort of striking.
Yes,
she had a sort of bit of a
fair.
Weird
well,
nose.
Long nose, a long pointy nose. It seems possibly she had a long pointy nose. There's certainly no contemporary suggestion that she was particularly beautiful. They do say she had a very beautiful voice and that she was very charismatic.
She seemed sexy.
She seemed
yeah,
sexy,
because she was
which I find is half the battle.
Her mouth is very small in that it only extends as far as the flare of her nostril.
Yeah, that is that isn't necessarily Cleopatra.
No.
No, no. Artist's impression.
The woman who's gone mad with some napkins.
Yeah. Yeah, she's gone serviette crazy.
Age cannot wither her nor custom stale her infinite variety, as Eno Barber said about her, I think. Now, how did Christopher Marlowe die?
Well,
now. Ta-da!
Yes. Let me say it so you can mock me. He died in a bar brawl being stabbed.
Dear me. No, well, he was stabbed, I'll give you that. But not in a tavern brawl. It was thought for many years it was a tavern brawl, but it wasn't until 1925 that the documents came to light in the Public Record Office that showed he was, in fact, killed at the house of a Mrs. Eleanor Bull by a man called Ingram Fraser, with whom he spent the whole day, and they had an argument over the bill.
An argument over a bill?
Yes. He stabbed him.
That's a bit harsh.
But so I need a mineral water. Yeah.
Yes, exactly.
So it wasn't a tavern.
No.
What was it the bill for, then? Was it a restaurant?
It was a pop-up might have restaurant.
They didn't call it a tavern. It was actually rather a smart restaurant, but it went downhill after that stab.
It might have been a prostitute.
Right.
Might have been a brothel.
Oh, so it could have been a brothel bill.
I didn't have that.
No.
Yeah.
No. To be honest, the service charge in this case is redundant. Yeah.
I had one of them, two of them.
I asked for that, but it never happened.
Yeah. I ordered it, but
it was off.
Yeah. Yeah.
We'll chip in. We can afford that.
Yeah. Yeah. Why don't we just get one big one and all have a bit? Oh, I don't know. Oh, no, dear me. Anyway. Yeah, it's unlikely to have been a brothel, because he did say that he didn't trust anyone who didn't love tobacco or boys.
Well.
Anyway, what made Lord Byron limp?
That's a follow-up question.
Item 4 on the brothel bill. 8 hours of Morris dancing.
He had, from birth, a pronounced limp. L-I-M-P, pronounced limp.
So did he have a... They're not quite sure whether or not he had a club foot.
We know that, in fact, he didn't have a club foot. It's often said that he did, because that's the sort of one that people have heard of. He had a sort of withered leg, and you can tell from his boots. He was very athletic, and he was very... He hated this limp. But he swam the Hellespont, and he boxed, and he was very worried about his weight. He became possibly an early male anorexic, it seems. And he liked to spend money, did old Byron. He ordered batches of 24 a time of white linen trousers, which he only wore once. He also ordered silk handkerchiefs in batches of 100. Each one was 9 guineas, which was an average man's pay for the year.
So what was he? Was he coining it in with the writing?
He inherited at an early age the title and Newstead Abbey, which he spent very, very fast. But he was, in fact, incredibly highly paid. Yes, for every canto of Don Juan, his last great masterpiece, I think thousands he got for each canto.
So he would write a canto.
He was hugely successful. Yeah,
and white linen trousers.
Yes.
Is that sound like something out of Miami Vice?
He had to leave England because there was a scandal about him possibly having had sex with
a young
goat.
A barbell story at Cambridge. It was he kept a bear at Cambridge in his rooms, a bear. And the Master of Trinity said, the rules are absolutely clear, Lord Byron. No domestic animals. He said, I assure you, Master, he's not domestic, he's entirely wild. So he was allowed to keep the bat. But, there was a rumour that he had shagged his sister, and so that's what forced him
so
to leave.
So you didn't say the bear?
No, the bear. As far as I know, the bear...
Is that more horrific than shagging your sister?
Well, it's just different, really.
Yeah. It is.
It's probably braver.
Lord Byron limped because of an abnormality in one leg, but it wasn't a club foot, in fact. Now, what can the Queen do that an idiot can't?
By the looks of it, kill people with their own eyes.
Doesn't look in the best mood, though, I agree.
Tires of Morris dancing.
This is something she's allowed to do, but doesn't. But an idiot is not allowed to do.
Drive, vote.
Vote is the right answer. Most people think the Queen can't vote. She has every right to vote as any citizen. She's never exercised that, as far as we know. But idiots are not allowed to vote. And lunatics may only vote during their lucid periods.
So test them on the way into the food.
So it's a surprise that most people think that the royals can't vote. They can, they just choose not to. Mm. But alas, alack, and well away, our revels now are ended. These are actors, as I foretold you, were all spirits and are melted into air, into thin air. And we must consult the scores. Well, my gracious heavens. I'm afraid rather down the bottom of the list with minus 14, Bill Bailey. Four to the better with minus 10, Sue Perkins. Second witch with a very creditable plus 3, Alan Davis. But tonight's Prince of Denmark with 6 points is David Mitchell. It only remains for me to thank our dramatist personae, Sue, David, Bill and Alan, and to leave you with this perceptive thought from Robert Wilensky. We've heard that a million monkeys at a million keyboards could produce the complete works of Shakespeare, but now, thanks to the internet, we know that this is not true. Good night.
2, Steve Coogan takes the Bard into unorthodox territory, starring with David Arquette and Elizabeth Shue in Hamlet 2.